Alexa, open Brave Words Radio.
Welcome back to Brave Words Radio. Brought to you by Vox Protocol, the global leader in voice app entertainment. Brave Words Radio is an awesome musical extension of BraveWords.com, where we have been waving the flag of hard rock and heavy metal around the world for over 30 years. Since you have been here before, we hope you enjoy Brave Words Radio.
So please welcome the metal god to Brave Words, streaming for vengeance, and you're looking wonderful. Yes.
Hey, everybody. Hey, Tim. Hey, this is so great to be with you once again. Yeah, really cool.
So you know what? When we got the press release a couple of months ago about this new book, I'm like, I'm totally joking here. It's like, what the hell else could this guy have to say? And when I read the book, I'm like, holy shit. He's got a lot more to say, and it's beyond interesting. It's like, it's so riveting. Like, wow.
Thank you. Thank you. That's the best reaction anybody can could hope for, you know, when you make new music, when you make a new book. I'm so pleased that you enjoyed it. And yeah, another opportunity to, oh, he's flapping his lips again, you know. I just had such a blast making the Confess book with Ian that we immediately sought out what other possible opportunities there might be available to us. And, of course, this whole background stuff that goes on in our world that is mostly, you know, you see a band, you get the record, whatever. But what does it take to get that to happen? You know, what do you have to go through to get all of these great things that we love and see and hear and enjoy? What do you have to go through to get to that spot? And this is what biblical is all about.
So like the whole premise, like how and when did the whole scriptures kind of format idea come into your head? Like, because it's really, when you read it, it's like, wow, this is presented really wonderfully. It's a hell of a lot different, obviously, from Confess, but it's like, yeah, it's like, it's an open book.
Well, we took a liberty with the Holy Bible, like a lot of people have done through the decades of rock and roll, but it made a lot of sense, firstly, to call it biblical, because wow, I think everybody's life has biblical proportions. And then, of course, you look at the references that we have in the Bible, from Lamentations to Temptations to Revelations. All of these titles kind of leap out for an opportunity to have them kind of utilized in the heavy metal way. And that's why we thought it was a pretty cool template to utilize all these words and all these chapters and all these sermons and scriptures and put them into this kind of format.
It was really fun, but to be honest with you, it was a total teachable moment. It's like a textbook, and obviously you're not this kind of man, but like people would pay for this thing. You know what I mean? Pay for this knowledge, right?
Yeah, I think that what we've tried to do here, again, for anybody that's interested about the big machine of rock and roll, the big machine of heavy metal, is to bring you this information in a different way. You know, you go to business seminars and these events, these TED events, whatever, where these types of exchanges happen. And so that was another opportunity that was flipping around in our heads. How can we do that? But at the bottom line, make it entertaining. You know, don't forget that we have to have the anecdotes as well as the more serious, edgy stuff, if you want to call it that. So with Ian's great great ability to be my voice and to listen to me to talking for hours and hours and hours and then making a transcript out of it, we were able to present that in a kind of an educational, if that's the right word, manner.
What I know you can't summarize this whole event in your head in one word, but like, what do you think the most important takeaway is when people get to the end of this book?
Just the insight, just gaining the extra knowledge that, again, when you see your favorite band, and I always use the emphasis here on the live part of what we do, that anybody in a band will tell you it's not easy. It absolutely is not easy. A tremendous amount of hard work goes into getting from A to B to Z, the end, if you want to call it the end. And that if you wondered what the band had to get through, firstly, to put a band together, to get the chemistry of the band together. But if one member of a band isn't as committed and as dedicated to the rest of you, then things start to get a bit wonky, you know, things start to get a little bit shaky. That the writing process is an extraordinary feat of minds, brains coming together in the creative sense and making something very special. This whole attitude of teamwork, you know, because that's what it is in a band. We've talked about this before, Tim. You're a team of guys. It's no different to hockey or baseball or football or whatever. You know, the team has to be connected in the right sense of spirit and again, determination and dedication to achieve the final goal in the net or whatever you want to call it. So those aspects of who we are and what we do and how we got there, I talked about in depth in Biblical. And, you know, we all hear the stories about infighting in bands, drug abuse, alcohol abuse, difficulties with money, management, accountant, attorneys, all of that world that we see little snippets about here and there. We've tried to really go deeply into all of those areas and just to make it a real thorough experience.
So to go deeper to the roots, I recently read Keith Richards' biography, and the first Rolling Stones record was virtually all cover songs. And then him and Mick said, like, we need to try to figure out how to write a song. So it was a really great dawning when these musicians came together and, wow, we wrote a song. It was called Satisfaction or whatever, right? So, right?
Exactly. It's magical. Again, you and I have talked many times about that moment of going into the studio or just meeting at each other's house, and the quest for the day is to write a song. And how do you start? Where does that come from? Is it a riff? Is it a melody that the singer might have? Is it a riff the bass player might have? Is it a crazy drum beat that the drummer might have? All of these different components coming in from all of these different angles are parts of what begins a song. And again, through the book, we tell you how that can be sometimes incredibly difficult to achieve. 25 years to write Loch Ness and some of the other songs, Living After Midnight, Glenn banging away downstairs and keeping me awake. Those are the extraordinary different, you know, opposite ends of what we do as songwriters that we work through to achieve. And again, the real essence of a band is its ability to write really good songs. And again, that's just the manifestation of the chemistry of the guys who are writing and the end result. So again, go deeper into how a song is composed, is created.
Now, I come from the land of SCTV, and these wacky Brits, which you're part of, like Benny Hill and Mr. Bean and Monty Python, I think to have a sense of humor is part of how to survive in the music industry. And that's one takeaway when I'm reading this book. And you reference all these shows and all this fun stuff, right?
Yeah. And again, that's just part of trying to find a balance within the structure of the book. I think that to engage your reader, much like when you engage a listener to your music, you have to try and keep the attention throughout the time that you're investing into the book or the music. So for us, for Ian and myself, yeah, it's important to tell a story about a drummer climbing into the Scottish mist to bring down a set of ants. Talk about Spinal Tap. You know,
exactly.
Bad news. It's that, and yeah, you've got to laugh at it, but it's also a little bit of an indication of where sometimes the chinks of friction start to intrude into any band. You know, when we never saw you get to the top of the mountain, you were covered in mist. Well, I went to the top of that mountain, and I blah 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 blah. Well, okay, mate, whatever. You know, all of that. There's humor, but it's wrapped around a nugget of really vital kind of psychology of the way bands work with each other mentally. So, yeah, we can't lose that. We can't lose that in ourselves as musicians. I know some of the most fierce, outrageous, shocking performers in heavy metal and rock and roll, but they all have tremendous senses of humor. You've got to be able to get that in the right place.
Well, if you don't mind, because in the book, you really bounce around and it's wonderful. When was the last time you actually were in a church or went to church?
Wow, you put me on the spot. You see?
Today?
Do you know, when I look out of my window, I can see three churches.
Okay.
We're very churchy around here, and they're great places. What I love about churches, and I've been into many, when I do my tours, if there's a church nearby, it's great just to stick your head through the door. I think one of the great things about churches is that they're all very peaceful. You can be in the craziest, most incredibly noisy environment, and then as soon as you go into a church, it's just beautifully peaceful and puts you in the right mental place to do what you're there for to do. And wow, Tim, hand on heart, it's been a while. Okay. It's been a while. You know, I'm one of these, as we've talked about in Confess, I'm one of these people that you don't really have to go into a church to do the work that you want to do, although a church is a great place for connecting in a probably more profound way, especially if you're in a congregation, because that's what it's like going to see Priest at a metal show. It's the metal congregation, you know. We're all there for the same thing. We're all there for the same experience, which is what going to church is about. But you've made me think that I should...
No, I'm not trying to go there.
Put my shoes on and run to the church and prostrate myself in front of the altar and go, I'm here by the grace of Tim. Please save me, Lord, again.
Well, I've been dying to ask you this question because, like, what is, like, in your past, because the name Judas Priest is a little bit controversial. Maybe, obviously not now, but what, like, was the highest religious figure or institution that sent Judas Priest an email or a letter saying, we have issues with your name, sir?
I don't think we've ever had that in a written sense, besides being on big posters and placards that we had for a short while, as you may recall. I don't know whether you've ever experienced any of that up in Canada, but here in the States, there was a time, and occasionally still now, there'll be a person, two people, a a bunch of people who are denouncing Judas Priest because we're blasphemous, we're satanic, we're devil worshippers, everything we do is bad, all we promote is destructive ideas and all that kind of rubbish. So we've had our fair share of that, and there it is. But I don't think we've ever had anything formal. The one thing that we did have formal many, many years ago was from PETA, the ethical treatment of animals, asking us to stop wearing leather on stage. And of course, we told them, hang on a minute, we wear this thing called pleather, you know, because you put pleather in the washer after the show. And, you know, it's very kind of what you have to do to maintain a hygienic existence on the road. So, no. But again, you know, the satanic panic, as it's gotten to be called, raises its head every now and again. Not so much these days, thankfully.
Now, on August 16th, 1977, I was only 10, and like because of where I am here, I was always listening to AM radio, and I told my mom, the announcer said that this guy called Elvis just passed away, and she'd literally just fell to the floor, and I love the story about Elvis, and of course the Beatles, but Elvis, like, wow. Like, what did that mean to you? The pelvic thrusting.
Yeah, like so many people that have either had the great opportunity to live this long life, said the 71-year-old metalhead, to people that investigate the roots of rock and roll and Elvis, along with Little Richard and Bill Haley and the Big Bopper and everybody like that, they are the foundations of where we came from. So when I first heard Elvis through that record player that my Aunt Pat gave me with those three singles, Elvis, Little Richard and Bill Haley, even as a little kid, that was just like an electric shock of energy and excitement that I'd never heard before in my life at that very young age. And then as I grew and into my teenage years, I became aware of this guy called Elvis, and then of course, later on, when we saw him doing his comeback special in America in his leather outfit and everybody going crazy because this guy wasn't God in the true sense, not only his voice, but his just his persona and everything that he carried about himself, was a remarkable man. Elvis was as important as the Beatles in that respect, in the way that they revolutionized music, not just music, but society. You know, when Elvis came along and started swiveling his hips, and they wouldn't show him, when he was on TV, they wouldn't show him from the waist down, because, you know, people were thumping the Bibles at church, and it's this guy's sake, but no idea. So all of that is wrapped up in Elvis. He's an incredible figure to look at in the cultural sense as much as the musical one. So, yeah, we had to include him in the book for all of those reasons and more.
Now, you brought him leather. I spoke to Wolf Hoffman from Accept last week. And who?
Hey, Wolf. They're on the road, aren't they? Great.
And the road again. He was talking about opening up for Judas Priest in the early 80s and walking by your dressing room and always smelling the leather and somebody maintaining the leather. I love the whole Marlon Brando story. And it was really pivotal, like just you guys doing photos and then finally figuring out, let's do the photo with leather. And that just took things to the stratosphere.
It's just part of the wonderful treasures and memories that this band contains. And the visual aspect of any band, even now, is vitally important. How are you going to look? What is your visual style going to be? Are you just going to stand there in T-shirts and jeans, if that's your thing? Or are you going to don yourself head to toe in leather, whips, chains and studs? And for us, when we made that great discovery of seeing that look and immediately feeling that is the way we sound, that is who we are as a band. This is our music. If you want to know what our music looks like, in a picture, take a look at these guys, how they're dressed. And so, yeah, the whole adventure of searching for that really important moment is just one of the many great stories of Priest, but a really important one.
Well, leather was obviously important to the growth of heavy metal, but do you remember the first time you actually threw the horns to an audience?
Oh, wow, what a great question. What a great question. I don't know. Wow.
What a great answer. Great question.
Yes. Great. My answer is dunno. Confused.com. But it's an important question because that is our worldwide thing, isn't it? You do that to anybody in the street, no matter where you are in the world, and people know you're into metal or you're a metalhead. Let's think about when Ronnie did it first. When did Ronnie first do that? You know, did he do that when he was with Sabbath, or whether he was on his own? I don't recall. He's the man I always go to. He's my go-to guy for a lot of things, even today. And by the way, I still have yet to see his documentary. I just haven't had time, but I hear it's absolutely fantastic. I don't know. Let's throw out sometime in the late 70s. Right. I would imagine we'd start doing that. I don't see it in a Priest. Never seen it in a Priest music video, come to think of it. Unless it's been in like a live video when this is going on all over the place. But as far as actually...
Do that again.
the first picture, you know. There's two ways of doing the horns. Is that way? That's the Ronnie way.
Yes.
This is my way, yes. You know. But it's just a beautiful thing, isn't it?
Did Ronnie know about your Priest show soundtrack?
How do you mean by that?
Well, you say it in your book. You were playing Holy Diver and Last in Line, or like there was a couple of like Ronnie James Dio songs that you, before you walk out on stage.
Oh, got it. Okay. Now I know what you mean. Yes. Yes. I don't know whether he ever heard about it or knew it. I mean, I still do it now, which is part of my pre-show ritual. You know, I get myself psyched up, not just for me, but you know, the band, we're all in the same dressing room. And, you know, an hour out before the show, I just start cranking up all of these different great pieces of music to get you in the right frame of mind to go out and burn the building down. So my very best of Dio, as I've got in my collection, that's always on. And then of course all of my other mates from all these different bands as well. But if we're just referencing Ronnie, yes, I have to hear his voice before I go on stage. It's just important to me, and it makes me do the best that I'm trying to do.
Wow, that's really touching. Wendy would love to hear that, and she'll see it soon. You talk about the fans. When was the last selfie that you asked to take with somebody?
Probably just recently in the Netherlands with... No, it wasn't with the Netherlands. It was King. It was King Diamond.
And yes, that was a beautiful photo. Wacken. Wow.
It was in Wacken.
Yes.
Yeah. Actually, just before I was speaking to you, we'd be talking to each other because we just found out today that officially it's been announced that we're doing this big show in Mexico City together. And
BraveWords is one of the sponsors. BraveWords is
one of the sponsors. Yes, you are. So it's going to be Priest. It's Pantera. First official showing of Pantera, Merciful Fate, Behemoth. Who am I missing? Somebody else? Oh, and Striper are on the bill, just to keep it all keep it all balanced, you know. But is that crazy? You know,
it's Priest, a crazy bill.
Merciful Fate, Pantera, Behemoth.
What do you think about the whole Pantera thing? Everybody seems to be on board, and wow, what an addition.
It's great. Everybody's passionate about the feelings with regards to whether you're for it or whether you're not. Hey, you make your mind up, you know. I think it's going to be tremendously successful because it's coming with the purest of intentions, and that you know, for the Pantera fans that really mourn and have great still loss for Dimebag and for Vinny, to have this moment to go and hear the voice of Pantera, Phil Anselmo, and the bass of Pantera with Rex, but then to have it balanced with two guys that are as hardcore Pantera fans as you possibly can be, yeah, and are also were great friends of Dime and Vinny, and the fact that if you read the interviews, you know, the discussions that they've had with each other about the band and jamming together and so on and so forth, it's all coming from the right place. It's all legitimate. It's not being done for any other reason than the pure joy of reliving Pantera's music again. And we know that Zach's going to be phenomenal. We know that Charlie's going to be phenomenal. So what else do you need, you know? And I'm sure that Diamond Vinny will be looking down with the horns up.
I'm going to continue to bounce around while we have a couple more minutes left. The last time you asked for an autograph.
Ooh, I can't remember. It's been ages. I don't really ask for autographs. I'm a selfie dude. I'm in that selfie world. Yeah, I can't really remember. I'll have to pass on that one.
Is there a moment when you wished you had your phone with you to take a photo and you didn't?
Well, I always, my memory always reminds me of that moment some time ago now where I was backstage at some awards in Los Angeles. And you know, photographers, rock photographers, it's always a case of, oh, there sounds so again. On this night, there was nobody there. So there's Ronnie, there's Alice Cooper, there's Zach, there's Dave Mustaine, there's me, and there's two or three other people. And we're all together in a huddle in the corner. And there's no photographer in sight, you know? And it was after that event, and we all had cell phones, but none of us took our cell phones out and said, hey, let's get everybody together for a picture. It's crazy, you know, it's absolutely nuts. So yeah, that's a memory they're either very intrusive or they're very, oh my God, what was I thinking? You know, why didn't we take that moment when it happened?
Would you like to ask my answer?
Yes, please. Absolutely. Throw it at me.
When we had dinner in Manhattan.
What year was that?
It was during the Halford solo era.
Okay, I remember.
So we're talking like mid to late 90s or something. We were like, it was just you and I. And I'm like, yes. Wow, where's my phone? Where's It was a beautiful moment. Wow. Very honored, obviously.
It's also the right opportunity, isn't it? When we were in Copenhagen recently, I went downstairs to just go out for a walk, and as I walked out in the bar, I see Richie and Andy and Ian with Steve and Nico, and I'm like, oh my God, you know, there's a photo. So I kind of snuck into the conversation, and we were just talking about this, that, and the other. And then very aggressively, I give my phone to Ian and I go, here, take a picture of me and Steve and Nico. And we took a picture, and it was really rude. I mean, you know, that's just, you know, fangirling, fanboy intuition taking over. I shouldn't have said, the thing about doing that is you should always ask. You should always, is it cool to take a selfie together? Is it okay to take a photograph? Don't just stick everybody's face in front of the camera without asking. But, you know, thankfully, Steve and Nico, being the great guys that they are, they were very gracious. And that's on the Instagram.
Can I show you my latest Halford collectible?
Yeah, let me have a look. Is it the Funko Pop? Where's mine?
No, I've got yours here. But
have you got mine there?
Ask me why. Okay. I have two.
Well, I would like to know, firstly, two is better than one, but why have you got two?
Well, because I'm a collector, and the other one I can open up and put in a bathtub with me.
Ah, there you go. That's a great idea. Get in the bathtub with Rob Halford.
I love that.
Yeah. Now there's something to send me. Put that on my Instagram. Send me a hashtag. Me in the bath with Rob. God knows what's going to happen in that department.
How does that process roll out in terms of is it Jane or who is the last sign off with like, yeah, that looks good. Let's put it out to the public.
Well, in the fun card thing, they're wonderful people. They approach you first and they talk about the opportunity and there has to be like a legal exchange of green lights.
Of course.
But that's really cool. Because over the years, I've seen all my friends be Funko popped, you know, from Slayer to Kiss to everybody. And I'm like, I want to be a Funko pop. Now I am one. And it's great. It's beautiful. Who knew? Who knew?
And you know what? Kiss has a coffin. What product would you like to see the Judas Priest logo on? I know it's morbid, right? But what Judas Priest logo, or like, would you like to see your logo on?
Oh, yes, these really, my mind goes in a bazillion directions. I don't know. I'll throw it back at you. What do you think we should stick our name on? Because it's been done. Gene's done everything. Gene and Paul have done everything.
He's absolutely done everything. Yeah. Maybe like the Rob Halford condom. I have no idea.
I don't know. Yes, condoms are very important, folks. So we'll stick a rubber on.
Jimmy Page was here a couple of years ago talking about his photo book, and he said every Led Zeppelin album started with the foundation with John Bonham playing drums, and there's news about the new Priest record getting done. Why are the vocals last? Is that what you prefer, or
no? This is unusual. This is really unusual because normally I'm doing my vocals along with the way the rest of the thing is coming together, but this all kind of strings back through the pandemic times, and so in this case, the foundations for pretty much all of the songs came with Richie and Scott playing live together in Nashville, I believe. So the root of the record is live in that respect, in the way the anchor was put down and some of the rhythms were put down. And I wasn't going to do my vocals remotely because I just don't like that idea. You know, we agree from the basic format of the demos that this is where we're going to go, including the vocal demos, and then the slog, as I call it, of actually putting it down in the truest professional sense starts to happen. So everything's done, you know. Everything's been done. I mean, it's just me. Everybody's waiting for me. And I've got it all here. I know all the words. I've got all the melodies. It's just trying to find the right time and place to do it. And we're close to making that happen. We're close to making that happen.
Beautiful.
It's done. The record is done apart from me. But we're very close to getting the vocals done. And then all the other work gets into getting the right time sequence of events for the release.
Do you have another minute?
Yes.
Let's get personal, because you and I would get along very well, and you know where I'm based. I'm based in a snowbank, but I live in shorts all the time. Rarely it's weddings and funerals. Even my wedding, I didn't have shorts. I mean, I didn't have pants on. So you live in shorts, and I had a pug about 20 years ago. He passed about 5 years ago, and he snored so fucking loudly that I had a fan. I had to put a fan. So like, I cannot sleep without a fan. So I'm like, I'm reading this thing. It's like, this guy only wears shorts and he sleeps with a fan. I love that. I love you.
Well, yeah, that's just when I talk about my insomnia in the book, I talk about, you know, when I go to sleep, it's like this big ritual where I have to have all of these things happening for me to be able to even attempt to get ready to go to sleep. I mean, everybody else just jumps into bed, you know, throws the duvet over and they're off. At least some of my friends do. I don't know about, everybody else, but you know, for me, it's just this big ritual of bed's got to be in the right direction, has to be pulled away from the wall, the room has to be a certain temperature, it has to be pitch black, it has to be as dark as the exorcist coming at the breath out your mouth, have to be like eight pillows, have to have an electric fan on the vent, electric fan on the bed, vibrating the bed, all this crazy stuff, you know. So that's just a bit of information that I wanted to share with my fellow, because not all of us are insomniacs, thank God, but I know a lot of us have trouble sleeping. So maybe the fact that you should pull the bed away from the wall so it doesn't become a soundboard from anything that's going on above or below you. All this trivia, you know, heavy metal trivia. Do you know what Rob Halford does to get to sleep? Check it out in Biblical, out now.
Last question, because there was one of my hockey mentors that said, the good Lord made very few perfect heads, and the rest he put hair on. And hair is, so keep that with you. That's a fun little, but hair is a big thing. It was a big deal.
It was a big deal. It was a big deal for the longest time, you know, in heavy metal, especially. Having that big long haired vibe was part of the formal way we presented ourselves, the long hair, the battle vest, the jeans, the sneakers, the bullet belt, I've still got the wristbands, the rings, all that kind of stuff. But then when that's something that you can research for me for the next time we talk, Tim. When was the first bald metal head? When did having short hair? Remember the drama when Metallica cut the hair? Oh my God, the world was losing its mind for days and days and days. But this whole thing about Samson, you know, when you lose your hair, you lose your strength and your masculinity. What a lot of balls that is. But it's an important and fun discussion to have. But yeah, when I talk in the book about noticing that I was becoming follically challenged, as they say in the commercials, why don't you try blah, blah? I said, forget that shit. Give me a razor blade. And let's get it out from there. And now it kind of, you know, sprouted down here. Because again, as I say in the book, having a beard makes you look interesting. Makes your face look interesting, you know, if it ever was interesting.
It grows everywhere else aside from here, right?
Yeah,
that's right. Last little note. I think Angry Anderson from Rose Tattoo, like that's right. Maybe that was the first.
Brilliant. Yes, absolutely brilliant. I remember those very first ever songs from Rose Tattoo and seeing Angry, because again, there was this thing. Oh, well, he must be a skinhead, you know. He must be a Nazi. He must be a racist. A lot of bullshit that is and was and is. I think this whole bald dome thing has become a great metaphor for just letting people be who they want to be.